Hello, everybody. Welcome to Webinar Wednesday. My name is Martin Lofvers. I'm the Chief Trend Watcher of Supply Chain Media. You might also know me as the Editor-in-Chief of Supply Chain Movement, the European Quarterly. And in the Netherlands, I'm also the Editor-in-Chief of Supply Chain Magazine. And I'm also the architect of the maturity matrix of supply chain startups in Europe. And we're going to talk about it later on. And with me, I have three experts on supply chain startup matters. So welcome. So with me, you see me on the left, and with me, I have three experts, Matthias Bosse. He's investor at Seed and Speed Ventures and founder of the Supply Chain Management Startup Handbook. Matthias, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
And next, we should have Emilia Ivakov, the CEO of Windle. And Windle is the winner of the European Supply Chain Startup Contest 2021. She will be joining shortly, but we'll check if she will be in time, but we'll manage. So we'll catch up with her later on. And next, we have Jan Pronk, Chief Commercial Officer of Big Mile. And Big Mile is the winner of the European Supply Chain Scale-Up Contest 2021. So Jan, welcome.
Yeah, thanks, Martijn, for inviting me.
All right. So some household stuff. So this webinar will be recorded, and the slides will be made available as PDF, so you can focus on the discussion. All the participants, except for the experts, are on mute, so you can have your questions asked during the webinar. So there will be a Q&A at the end, so that's one thing. But next to that, you also have a Q&A function in AirMeet. You see the Q&A functionality on the right side. So if the questions are in line of the conversation we are having with the experts, I will ask these questions immediately to make it interactive. And if your questions are unanswered, you know, there will also be an after talk at 5 o'clock. So this would look like this. So the three or the four of us, also with Emilia, will join at table one and at 5 o'clock. So you can also have a conversation with us at 5 o'clock, and it will look like this. And if you go join a table, it's look like a Zoom meeting or an a Microsoft Teams kind of meeting. So you can have a discussion over there. So you can even use the chat function, but everybody can see the chat function. But if you have questions to me or the experts, you can ask questions there. Ah, Emilia is also joining us. Emilia, can you hear me?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, right. So no problem. You're here, so that's fine. All right. So I explained the AirMeet functionality at 5 o'clock. So we will join at 5 o'clock over there. So let me go there. So Matthias, to introduce you, please introduce yourself, and then we can tell why we have asked you to join.
Yes. So first, thanks a lot, Martijn, for having me on this webinar. Just some brief words about myself to give the audience a bit of background. So I actually turned 40 years this year, and it's more than 20 years ago that I started my studies in economics with a specialization in transport and logistics, and I worked some years in the field. I then decided to leave logistics for a moment and spend 10 years in different consulting companies, basically focused on all kind of transactions. Every now and then I had also projects in transportation and logistics, so the topic stayed with me. So I took some educational steps as well, as not unusual in the consulting industry. I did an MBA, I did a CFA, and were really deep into those corporate finance things before I then decided to be a bit more entrepreneurial and joined a really early stage startup for more than 3 years. I helped to build a small e-health company for 3.5 years with a lot of fundraising, with a lot of liquidity management for a small startup and trying to bring a product to market and commercialize it, which then finally went well after 3.5 years. And then one of our investors more or less asked me to join the investor side, which I found an interesting adventure, and joined the venture capital fund, which is now 5 years ago, before I then switched sides again to Seed and Speed Ventures. And also during my venture capital career, the topic of supply chain management was with me more or less all the time, because every now and then we looked at cases, especially software companies, before we then also did the first two investments, which were actually last year. So happy to deal with that topic a bit more detail. And we've looked at the space for some years now, and there's really some interesting developments I think we will discuss later on.
All right, thanks. So Amelia, I have announced you what your function is, but maybe you can introduce yourself briefly and then introduce your pitch or what Brindle is doing.
Yes. So thank you, Martin. So I'm Emilia Jevekov, CEO and co-founder of Windle. We started Windle 6 years ago now, and I've been working before Windle in entrepreneurship field with different experiences in different sectors, consumer goods, fashion, and also more on the financial part. And my co-founder, who is the CTO of Windle, has an experience in supply chain and important B2B software implementation.
Okay, so I explained that you are the winner, or Windle is the winner of the European Supply Chain Startup Contest 2021. So you can explain possibly what the proposition is, and then you can.
Yes, for sure. So with Windle, what we try to address, and what our objective is to help our clients with a quite challenging question, is to know exactly where are their goods and in which quantity at any steps of their supply chain. We started Windle based on a quite impressive figure, which is that more than 80% of the supply chain directors have no real-time visibility and direct access to their up-to-date information related to their purchase orders and supply chain operations. Basically, from purchase order, which is placed in an ERP, to the moment when the goods are delivered in a warehouse or to a factory when we are talking about components, or to a final client, there are different operational steps that are handled by different teams which are relying and depending on potential external partners, such as suppliers or freight forwarders. And all this is major cases handled and managed with fragmented process, a lot of email communication, different Excel spreadsheets. And so there is no way to have a direct and reliable access to up-to-date information. So that's why we created Windle, and this is what we are bringing with Windle. Is it's a unique collaborative platform that enables to get this real-time collaboration between all the stakeholders of your supply chain. So basically, the platform will connect both to IT systems, will be accessible to the different operational teams, so the buying team, the transport, logistics or supply teams, and also accessible to the different external supply chain partners, potentially through IT connection or with a simple login password access, and will enable everyone to get a dynamic management of the purchase order and the transportation daily operations. So the platform will bring a real-time user dashboard and alerts, and helping to really remove all the low added value tasks, such as sending a reminder to a supplier to be sure that he's able to meet your requested delivery date or validate the availability of a document or any operational things, to remove all this and rely on all the intelligence of the platform to organize the operation things, and help all the teams with intelligent and smart alerts to identify as soon as possible the potential issues that you may have between the purchase or the placement and the final delivery. So the idea is really to get the information that PO will be potentially delayed, that you will have quantities, discrepancies, and so on, to streamline all the communication and lower the impact at the end of the journey. So it's really to get a unified follow-up and not a siloed management, which results all the time in information gap and a low ability of communicating efficiently. And beyond this daily collaboration, which is much more efficient, the objective of Windle is also to bring a data-driven management, managing everything in a structured way, enable the supply chain organization to get a lot of different KPIs on the platform. Of course, KPIs on the supplier's performance, on time delivery, on time in full, but also what is the average time a supplier takes to validate the orders, the number of times he will change or update the delivery time, the number of splits of the delivery and so on, and to get objective data to efficiently identify the performance levers of your to improve your supply chain. And the last important thing to explain about Windle is that so it is a unique web platform, and it is designed to be easy to configure so that each supply chain organization can get something, and I mean a work environment which perfectly reflects the reality of its operation on the ground. So we have a very flexible platform, and flexible also because it is simple to manage and accessible to non-IT people, which is very important when we are talking about business solutions.
Before we get to the benefits, I got a question from your audience. What distinguishes Windle from all other supply chain visibility platforms or real-time transport visibility platforms like Project 44, Forecast, and Shipio?
Okay, all the transport visibility platform that you've mentioned are focusing on the real-time transport visibility. What we do offer with Windle is a level of visibility which is a complement to those transportation visibility platform, because we are talking about the purchase order and the product level. Mm-hmm. We are able to track what is in this shipment, and to get all the steps that have been validated and proceeded before the transportation. So the difference is the level of visibility, and we are much end to end, including PO management and not only the transportation management. And so we are not relying on the same technologies as those real-time visibility transportation platform.
Okay, clear. So what are the benefits?
So the benefits are multiple. The first immediate and very accessible benefit is, of course, a question of productivity. As I explained, the objective of Windle is really to focus on a high added value tasks and remove all the manual task, double entry of the data in several systems and so on. So since you are able to get a platform which is connected to your IT systems and accessible to your external partners, your import and supply teams are able to increase significantly their productivity. You can see figures here that one client gets thanks to Windows. So we are talking about a very important gain in productivity. The visibility, which is the strategic objective with Windows, is really to increase the visibility so that everyone at the different steps of the supply chain is able to anticipate issues much more efficiently and so to limit. We will not be able to prevent from a production breakdown or a delay on the grounds. I mean, when the something happens, we will not be able to solve the problem, but we'll be able to alert everyone that there is something that will potentially impact the final delivery date or the quantities and so on. And this is this ability of sharing key information in a structured way and as soon as possible, which has a very important impact on the global supply chain performance and, of course, on the satisfaction of the client in the end. And also the one benefit of Windows is the ability of controlling what's happening on your supply chain operations. A lot of supply chain organizations do have a lot of extra costs because when you are not controlling efficiently your lead times or your transportation plan, for example, you are buying more express transport or buying extra cost from the freight forwarding or I mean you are invoiced by the freight forwarders for extra costs or demurrage fees or things like this. And so the fact of getting all the information once again in a dynamic way accessible, it really helps to identify precisely where are the sources of extra costs and being able to reduce them in your operations. So the platform is compatible with a lot of different type of supply chains. We are currently working and helping clients in the retail and consumer goods industry, but also in the building industry. We are also working with a freight forwarder who is integrating the Windows PO management in his service offer. So it is really flexible and able to address different use cases. And so the implementation of Windows from really the kickoff of the conception phase up to the go live is in average of 4 months. And we have currently more than 3,000 users on a daily basis that are collaborating on Windows to share efficiently all the key information related to the purchase order.
I was wondering, you know, I see SAP and LVMH. So what is the connection with SAP in this matter?
We are a partner with SAP. We have developed an integration with their Ariba solutions. Okay. And we are also having connections with the SAP ERP to different clients.
And LVMH, is that a customer, you know, the fashion brand or?
We've been, selected by LVMH in their startups accelerators, and we are currently in discussion with different brands of the group.
Okay, great. So here are some contact details, but I'll later on, and you can connect to Emilia. So thanks for this, and, you know, we get some questions later on. Jan, could you explain something about Big Mile? And Big Mile is the winner of this year's supply chain scale-up contest in Europe. So maybe you can explain, Jan, what Big Mile is doing.
Yeah, of course. You can immediately go to the next sheet. Yes, we are, as Big Mile, a CO2 calculating, allocating, and reporting and analyzing platform. basically founded 1 year ago in the middle of the COVID crisis, actually. But the platform itself was initiated by the Dutch government already in 2015, based, of course, on the Paris Agreement in 2015. The Dutch government also said, okay, for the sector of mobility and logistics, we have to monitor and we have to get an impression what's the current status and how we can influence and at least monitor the situation and the trend line of the CO2 emissions for the coming up years. And for that, a new platform has to be developed, and that platform was BigMail. So with this platform, we have founded and created a unique platform to report through the whole supply chain, from transport company to the shippers and the big brands at the end, to give insights in a formal way to report and analyze your global footprint in your supply chain.
And you also created a new German office recently?
Yeah. That's correct, because we think in terms of momentum, it's very important to make large and quick steps to get BigMail started, and then you can go to the next sheet if you want to, Martijn. We really think that there needs to be one standard, independent third-party platform to do these calculations, especially in the near future where CO2 will be required to report at least, and of course later on there will be taxes on CO2 as well. And then you go into the situation that in your whole chain the billing of CO2 will be charged in this chain. So the transporter will bill it to the supplier. The supplier will charge it to the shipper, and so on and so on. And then you need an undiscussable standard in CO2 calculation, and that's where we place ourselves to be the standard.
Right. I know that maybe for an international point of view, Lean and Green, that's a Dutch initiative in logistics, and you've been part of the program on that, you know, and also a lot of multinationals in the Netherlands have been joining that Lean and Green initiative and embrace this kind of CO2 reduction program, and hopefully they are also embracing BigMail as a platform. So maybe you can explain a bit more about the platform itself.
Yes, of course. We are really a cloud-based platform, and as already discussed before, and Amelia was pointing that out quite well as well. In supply chain, there are always more stakeholders, more parties involved. And it's really important also in terms of a complete view on the CO2 in this chain to get all parties on board. And for that, we have a really great data sharing functionality in our platform, what makes it really easy for every stakeholder to dive into this data, but not only your own data, but also the data produced by your contract partners in your chain. And we are doing that, of course, on all regulations and laws available and methods that are defined to do a proper CO2 calculation in your supply chain and in your transport. Yes, it's multimodal. We can cover planes, ocean freights, boats, but also the train and, of course, trucks and the vehicles. We are supporting the COFRET and the EN16258 methods. We have different key industry figure standards we support, like the GREC framework, the CO2 emissions factors in the Netherlands, Smart Race in America, and CO2 objective in France, for example. But you can also work with your own key figures if you have them in place, and if you want to benchmark yourself against those global industry standards. But the platform thought in behind that makes the platform really unique.
All right. And so what is your basic need that you are addressing as BigMail?
Yeah, you can actually start with, as we call it, carbon footprinting on different data quality and completeness stages. What I often say in commercial meetings is that if you start getting your CO2 in your chain. But of course, the more detail of data you have, the better and more spot on will be. So the best data entry is your data of fuel consumption on daily trip level. If you have that in place together with your volumes of your shipments and the location of origin and destination, then gold plus, as we mentioned it, data to calculate your CO2. But of course, a lot of customers do not have that in place, and a lot of companies do not have even have their own vehicles like a DHL or a CIVA, or big brands who do not execute their own transports. So then you can also start with let's say other lower detailed data. And in the beginning, from gold to bronze, if you have only your origin and destination addresses and your shipped cargo in volume, then we can already, using those key figures from the industries, we can already start with the low level reporting of your CO2. And that's always a good starting point.
Right. And this statement is quite clear. So how you can start with it. So that there should be any hurdle to start with it.
No.
Okay. Yeah. So, right. And so who are your users at this moment?
Yeah, it's quite a mixture. We are already quite proud of it that we have this great list. It's really a mix between really transport companies, the 4PL logistic service providers, and also some names, brands, and suppliers and producers of goods and systems. And together with that, we already have started a good lobby with great partners we work together with. You mentioned already Leaning Green. And Leaning Green is also international. So we have already in 8 different countries, we have for Leaning Green also partners of Big Mail. We have signed a contract together with the EvoVenex last week, the branch organizations for shippers and brands in the Netherlands. We have a cooperation with Thuiswinkel.org, that's the e-commerce instance for all retailers and e-commerce shops in the Netherlands, and some nice integration partners and cooperations with other software companies.
Yeah, and now you're also moving into Germany, so you're going to extend it, across Europe. As Supply Chain Media, we're going to help both Big Mail and Windmill to extend across Europe with our marketing campaigns we're going to launch shortly.
Yeah, so really great.
Thanks for this. This is introduction of both the startups. And now we get to into more discussion mode with the three of us. And also Matthias will explain what he has been doing. What we have seen, and this is a slide I've used. We did a webinar on supply chain startups globally together with McKinsey in last September. And what this slide is showing based on McKinsey figures, and they have based it on CB Insights, Crunchbase, and other website that, there's an uptake in logistics startups in the last few years. You can see it like this, and it's peaking, in 2018, and also still high in 2019, and then, 2020, then we got in the COVID area. Matthias, from an investor side, do you recognize its vendors? So what is your experience on your side when you look at the logistic startup industry globally and also in Europe?
Yeah, so I think we would be a bit more focused on Europe. And I would say what supports these numbers here is that, and I will come to that later on, maybe a bit more in detail, I think. So logistics or the whole field of supply chain management has been increasingly interesting for investors as well. So I would say around, 3 to 4 years ago, that really picked up in terms of more and more venture capital funds looking at the space and trying to place some investments there. And that's across the board. So it's sort of logistics in a narrower sense. It's procurement, warehousing, etc. So it's across the board. And I think I would totally agree that this space has become hot from an investor's perspective.
Yeah. And what they have done, McKinsey has created 11 segments in this logistics startup arena, I would say. You have the courier environment, the storage, the warehousing part, the transport as such, with pallets and containers and what they call tech. And they have also mentioned some brands. You see the brands on the right hand side, the examples. In my opinion, you know, there's a lot of focus, especially in Silicon Valley in the US and also in the Far East, on unicorns and the big names. You see Flexport as already, I think, a unicorn over there. So that's one thing. Also, you see Relax. That's more like a software vendor from Scandinavia. But also Forkite, you see on the lower right side, you know, that's a real-time transport visibility. So there's a mixed bag, I would say, of startups and scale-ups. But basically what they are saying, on the courier area, the new last mile delivery models, there's the most of the funding, and this is a global figure. And if you go from the first one, last mile, they see as a category, road freight marketplaces and solution. That's the one. Warehousing, so what we call on-demand warehousing. You know, it's like the Airbnb for pallets, I would say. New entrants in parcel business. They see that's a delivery area. Air and ocean transportation. They see and that's the Freightos and Flexport area. Big players over there. Traditional third-party or contract logistics, we get to that, you know, we see it as a first-mile solution, I would say. Asset tracking with the chip sensors and RFID mentioned. B2B e-commerce specialists, also of interest. We will get to that. We have our own definition. Intelligent providers with AI applications, Xeneta and Forkite. I see Forkite already as a scale-up established in real-time transfer visibility. Inventory and order management, that's a clear area. And blockchain, that's the definition of McKinsey. And based on that, you know, what they saw, Courier Express and Parcel has the highest funding. To me, you know, it's quite explainable that, you know, you have a DHL of this world, and that looks like a big market and an understandable market, in my opinion. What do you see, Matthias?
Yeah, so I think I would agree. So especially the first two categories. So I think so on the one hand, it's so that are the largest markets, at least by volume in terms of revenue, et cetera, even if it's maybe low profitability. But for sure, both are markets which are really huge, and even the biggest startups don't even have significant market shares in that regard. But so I think what comes into play here also is that the upper two segments are more or less much driven by volumes, right? Mm-hmm. So you need to really be big and have kind of a critical mass. And to reach that, you really have to grow fast, become big, and that costs a lot of money. So from an investor's perspective, I'd like to say, okay, those are also two segments that are easy to understand, right? So everyone can imagine and can understand products and off-service offerings here, and digitalization kicks in more easily than maybe in other spaces. So I think that's totally okay that those numbers are as they are.
All right. Now we get deeper into the supply chain. So what Supply Chain Media has been doing the last 3 years, we created our own overview of supply chain startups. And to explain this, we have decided to have 10 categories. And from left to right, you have on the supply side up to the customer side on the right-hand side. So we have from left to right, supplier management, that's your procurement area. Then next, a new one for this year, we have created supply chain sustainability. And that's where Big Mile is playing a role. So that's the second one from the left. Then ocean air freight forwarding. You see a lot of players, and these are only European players. So there you see a lot of them, you know, in air cargo and ocean cargo. Then the on-demand warehousing, we saw it already. We see some three players here in Europe, but there used to be Stoga and a third one, warehouse.com, is still ready, but there are already two startups dropping out. So this area, on-demand warehousing, doesn't seem to fly that much. So that's our conclusion based on the metrics of the last few years. Then you have inventory counting and optimization. That's what we saw in inventory management is taking place according to McKinsey. So we created our own. And you see Flowlity, the French one. They were the winner of last year's startup contest. And they made it as a scale-up. And to explain it, we made a distinction between startups and scale-up. Startups are the smaller ones. And, you know, maybe have some first initial funding. But then you get to the scale-ups. And we made a distinction. If they have raised more than 2 million raised capital, they are becoming a scale-up. And there are some more figures behind it to make a distinction between startup and scale-up. So you see Windle, and that's the next one, visibility, tech and trace. And that's a mixed bag. Based on Windle, you see they base it on purchase order numbers and track it all the way to the chain. But you see other ones who are with sensors and tags, do track and trace of pallets or parcels. So Amelia, I think in your opinion, this is also a mixed bag if you look at this column of visibility, track and trace, isn't it?
Yes, for sure. It's a lot of different solutions on the field of visibility. Some of them are clearly an interesting complements to connect different visibility solutions to get this visibility at different granularity, which is clearly the important thing when we are talking about supply chain visibility now.
Yeah, and I see it in the market. There's a lot of confusion about what is visibility. And of course, we have the question, where are the real-time visibility players? So like Project 44, Shipio, in our opinion, they are beyond this startup area. And we have also SCM IT subway map. And on the subway map, you see these kind of vendors on their own subway line. And I can predict that, you know, this bunch of companies, startups in the category Windle, they will, you know, will be dissected in possibly different categories. And then you have supply chain blockchain next to that. It's also kind of a visibility, but based on blockchain. And we did a webinar earlier this year about this kind of startups and scale-ups. And people say blockchain is dead, but Nexiot and Ambrosius together already have raised 100 million euros. So these investors still believe in this area. And if you see what they are doing, these kind of Swiss blockchain startups or scale-ups, you know, they connect assets like trains into the blockchain. So where are my trains and the goods on my trains are heavy assets. So that's a big one. Then we come to the road and freight matching. You see a lot of well-known names like Sender and Freightlink in France and Instafreight in Germany. A lot of German road freight matching scale-up, I would say. Matthias, you are well familiar, you know, based in Berlin, of the German market. This is also a crowded field, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think what does make it even more complex is that a lot of solutions are showing kind of overlap between those categories, right? And it depends a bit on how you slice and dice the data and. What do you really sort the companies into which category? Because I think a lot of those solutions are also contributing to other fields and so could be used in a different way, and even with earlier stage startups, as you might know, there's also a lot of dynamic in their service offerings, and maybe they are pivoting from one sector to the other a bit using the same technology. So I think there's kind of movement here.
Yeah, and what I also see with like CargoNex, you know, that's a more younger player, I would say, compared to Sender, for example. You know, they claim to have better usage of machine learning AI to not only road freight matching ad hoc, but also looking into the future where we can expect shortages and freight capacity and already reserve capacity for the near future, in the next weeks or month. So you always also see within that column or category, you see new trends and new applications and new platforms, maybe leapfrogging each other. So that's also what you see in that area. And first mile, that is now okay. That's not the last mile stuff, but you want to have a third party do the logistics of your e-commerce or e-fulfillment. That's the one. And the final part is the last mile delivery. And that's also a big area where you see a lot of investment with the Budbee and Pack and more. So what we saw even in the last year, the end of last year and beginning of this year, you see a lot of investment in that area. And maybe that's also because of for investors that's already recognizable what's happening in that area. So last mile, of course, with the boom of e-commerce during COVID-19 pandemic, a lot of trucks getting at your door, delivering the stuff. So even the investors do know what's happening in the last mile area. And Lookabox is one of them. That's the winner of the European Startup Contest in 2018. So they got some new funding. So that's also hot in this area. Emilia, I got a question. About Windle, and maybe this explains how does Windle positions themselves versus planning systems like Blue Yonder or even SAP. And you have also Power BI as a visualization tool. Maybe you can
Regarding the planning the planning tool, we are a complement to those smart planning tools which are helping to define what are the purchase order that have to be placed and at which moment and in which quantities and so on. We are really focusing on the execution and the what we are addressing is that the ERP that are used to manage the execution are not collaborative enough and getting into the details. An ERP doesn't aim at managing the different document sharing that needs to be done by the suppliers for the transport organization and so on. So we are always connected with the ERP or with the planning solutions also it is possible to get the information from those solutions and manage all the very operational collaboration and also helping to get all these real-time dashboards. When I'm talking about dashboard, it's getting dynamic to-do lists and real-time alerts about what has to be done, validated, what are the information missing to move forward in the execution of the purchase order. And so it is also a complement to all the business intelligence solutions. Mm-hmm. We are offering a statistics module in Windle, which is enabling to get different KPIs in real time that I mentioned before, such as OTD, average delay by suppliers, by purchase order type, by product, whatever. But it is, of course, interesting to get all this data combined to information and data at the sales from a sales perspective, from a stock perspective, and of course this data is not in Windle, and so we are frequently also connected to the BI solutions to push all the detailed information from Windle to those BI solutions.
All right. What we have done also in our analysis, so we have these 10 categories, supply chain sustainability is not in it yet. What you see comparable what McKinsey has done. So the largest bar is road freight matching, and the second one is ocean freight. But blockchains and supply chain was high last year, especially with the Swiss examples, but also circular recent investment has some new funding, big funding in blockchain. So that's one to follow. And last mile is also catching up. And especially when we look at the end of last year and the beginning of this year, logistics started, Budbee collects 52 million euros and Parker raises 44 million euros. So you can imagine this is a big time investment. So probably Matthias, you've also seen this messaging of funding lately.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think there's really yeah. So those are two examples, but I think there are a lot of more. Yeah, really mega rounds in that space. So which is maybe due to an overall inflationary tendency in startup funding, but which is also due to supply chain management startups becoming more and more mature, right? So a lot of companies has been started. I don't know, 3 to 4 years ago, so now the grown-ups collect the bigger financing rounds, which is good to see.
Yeah, I got a question for the audience. Project 44 recently received an additional $200 million funding, which valued the company in excess of $1 billion, and they have an AR of only $50 million. Are we facing dot-com conditions in this space?
So not sure whether I can really answer this question. I think this is not only true for supply chain management, but this is true for all startup kind of investments, that multiples and valuations have gone up tremendously over the last 15 to 18 months, I would say. And even as an investor being active in this field for the last 5 years, it's every now and then it's really hard to understand what makes up the valuation then in some cases. But in any case, so there are a lot of companies that are really strongly growing, right? And these huge valuations and huge financing rounds are more or less than paying forward in terms of what this company might grow into. But for sure there is, at least I think I would be willing to say that there's really a lot of increased risk taking here. Absolutely. Yeah.
So what we have done last year with Supply Chain Media, we asked 106 manufacturing, wholesale and retail companies what their investment plans were or are. So there's, just after the first wave of COVID-19 last year. So you see a lot of investment plan and end-to-end supply chain visibility, big time. Inventory management and forecasting is another one. Real-time transfer visibility, especially in the more mature environments, there's companies with a level 4 or 5 supply chain maturity, there are a lot of plans in that area. So that's the difference between the orange bars and the blue ones. The blue are the total and the orange are the more mature companies. And also supply chain risk management, there's a lot of investments going on there, especially among the more mature companies. So they are looking at pre-wave and risk method and resilience 360. In the freight and execution and tenant platforms, you see relatively low investments. But my conclusion is, the companies are more planning to look at these startups or these scale-ups like CargoNex and we have mentioned before, and not so much the transporians of this world where you have heavy investments in that area. So that explains to me why these figures are relatively low on freight and execution and tenant platforms. All right, next we go to Matthias. So Matthias, like you already mentioned, you are in the middle of wrapping up or finalizing your handbook. Can you explain a bit more about this handbook?
Yeah, so absolutely, happy to do so. So, as I said in the introduction briefly, so I'm currently with the Seed and Speed Ventures, which is an early stage investment company from Berlin, not totally focused on supply chain management. So this is one of our special areas of interest, but still kind of a side project. So we started to look at supply chain management over the last year in a bit in detail, did a bit of landscaping, and also placed our first investments in the field, among others, into Prewave, to give a bit of transparency here. The idea then was this year to build up on this and take an even deeper dive, get to know more companies and an overview about the space. So we started a project, the Supply Chain Management Handbook, in which we, from a methodology standpoint, went out and asked startup and scale-up companies to register for the handbook and answering the quick questionnaire about what they do, what their status is, how much funds they've raised, which problems they solve, and for which customers they work already. So as Martin, you just said, we're in the middle of wrapping this up and doing a bit of analysis here. So we have 220 startups and scale-ups from Europe, from 27 countries, from the continental Europe, including the UK, covering 15 different verticals. And as we saw on the slides before that, so everyone builds his own structure and own verticals. So we did as well, but I think they're pretty similar to yours, Martijn. And then, so when we then came up with this idea, we got some interest from other experts from the industry as well. So we decided to also put a bit more content into the handbook than the company profiles itself. So we will have 10 expert opinions on startups, on accelerators, on logistic providers and consultants from the space, covering different topics. So the core of the handbook for sure are the profiles then from the startup companies, which also should give them a bit of visibility, a bit of platform to generate some leads, to build some network. And it's also great for us to have kind of a bigger network in the space. So we all did that not only on ourselves, but are really happy to being supported by some really good institutions. And first of all, to mention Martijn, you and Supply Chain Media, which also helped us to make this handbook known and generate some interest for it. So the other two are more or less two accelerators from Germany. I think many of you will know them, Starport from Duisburg and the Digital Hub Logistics in Hamburg. So I think it will take us some days and weeks to finalize it, but then towards the end of July, beginning of August, it will be ready. So just to maybe some highlights or some high level statistics from the companies we got data for. So 220 startups already a good number, but still compared to the whole employment in the logistics field, still tiny. But already those 220 employ roughly 7,400 employees, which was really interesting to see. So on average is 34, but so it's highly skewed distribution for sure to the bigger companies. So on average, the companies that registered are four years old, a bit older than 4 years. And I think that's also, as we just said, do then that the funding rounds become bigger and bigger as there are more grown up companies in the space than in the years before. From an investment perspective, so we more or less focused on total funding, so not too much on last funding rounds. So we also did that also a bit, but the main objective was to understand how much money was invested in that space. So out of those 220 companies, 137 got external funding, actually, according to the data, which is nearly $2 billion US dollars. So that was quite an impressive number. Mm-hmm. The highest funding in the space of a total of $350 million US dollars goes to one single company. So would be curious to know whether you could guess who it is, but...
No, tell me.
So it's actually it's Zender. So Zender.
Oh yeah, I should have known. Yes, sorry.
Zender and Porto clearly leading the pack here.
Yeah.
In terms of segments. So as I said, we were building some segments here as well. But just to explain it a bit. So the companies we asked the companies basically where their offering fits from their perspective, and there were multiple answers possible. So they could identify more than one segment in which they fit in. Mm-hmm. And what you can see here is kind of the distribution among all the 220 companies. Which mentions were most often. So with that, first of all, it really shows that those startups are really covering a huge variety of applications and areas within supply chain management, which was really good to see. But as you already pointed out on your slides, Martijn, there is kind of a focus in terms of the whole transparency issue, under which I would collect the visibility, risk management, traceability issues, and also the sustainability issues now covered by more and more startups. So I think that's obviously one of the really big challenges and aspects on which startups focus to make this whole system more transparent, and which might be then a good starting point to make it more resilient. In terms of distribution among countries, so that might be a bit biased due to our regional focus. So we decided to focus a bit on Europe. Also in the analysis, there were some companies from India, China, the US. We left them out and just focused on the European ones. Mm-hmm. Within that, at least one category in which Germany might be European champion, is the startup locations. So there were really a high number of startups coming from Germany. So 1/3 of all companies. So Eastern Europe. So we were happy that we got some registrations from Eastern Europe as well. Also, it were only 19 companies, so less than 10% of the total count. And for sure, so that's not only true for supply chain, but also true for supply chain. There's a lot of potential, I would say, in the Eastern Europe European startup ecosystem, also in supply chain management.
Yeah, I agree, and we have also mentioned a few Eastern European startups in our overview, but it's good to compare notes when you have finalized this overview. To wrap up on your side,
Yeah, so I think that's just following up on what we said earlier in terms of trends in funding. So I think COVID just caused a small pause, I would say, in terms of VC funding, and maybe it makes it a little bit more difficult to compare year over year. But at the latest in summer 2020, VC funding accelerated again, and I think here are some good examples for big or even mega rounds that happened after that period.
Yeah.
With Zender, Instabox, Forto, Shipeo, all the huge financing rounds, and that's in line what we said earlier. So they've become more mature, they're becoming more visible, they're attracting the big funds, and even VC funds get bigger and bigger and need to place bigger tickets. So that's totally in line with the maturity of that companies. And what's interesting to see, though, is that they also, even those not anymore startups, maybe becoming scale-ups or grown-ups, that they are starting to acquire businesses themselves.
Yep.
Which at least with Zender and Instabox and Shipeo is the case. And I think there are some rumors going around that there will be a lot more of those transactions, and maybe a bit of consolidation in which the grown-ups then join forces with smaller, younger, and maybe more specialized solutions.
Yeah. So here are the contact details. You will receive them later as watchers, as delegates. What we have done a health check. I go into the deep, not so much, but we did a Q1 assessment of startups, and they were very enthusiastic and optimistic about their visibility, their leads, their prospects and their projects, their uniqueness, very high, way too high in my opinion, the easiness to attract new employees, etc. They get more realistic in Q3 2019. So you see more yellow and red. Still, the uniqueness is way too high, in that sense. But then what we saw in the middle of last year, some trucks here. Anyway, so in the mid last year, you see more red. So COVID-19 has created the rough times for a lot of supply chain startups. So that's what we see here. So we will see how the startups and scale-ups will survive, and we will repeat this health checks together with Matthias probably just after the summer to see, okay, what's the status right now in the startup and health check environment. So we get to the end of this webinar, and it's been interesting, and a lot of things that you discussed. So there are some questions, you can read it and we can discuss it later. So there are some views how to look at startups from a supply chain manager's point of view, from a retailer, manufacturer, but also from the 3PL view, who are servicing these shippers and what should be the focus on startups, we can discuss later, and also from the investor side. We are almost on the hour, so I don't know if there are some burning questions. If so, I would suggest go to the lounge. So we will be here after the hour. So within a few minutes, we will join the lounge. You can join us at the table. We will be at table 1. For Emilia, just click on the arrow to the left next to the Aramid logo. And the rest, you can join us at the lounge to ask your questions, if so. Here are some contact details. You can download the maturity matrix in 2021. The supply chain handbook will be released soon. And also, you can go to the Windle website and Big Mile to have more information about this great startup and scale-up solution. So with this, for now, Jan, Matthias, Emilia, I would like to thank you for your participation. So Jan, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
And you will joining also next in our table. Matthias, thank you for your information.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It was really great.
And Emilia, also thank you for joining us.
Yes, thank you for having us.
No problem. So maybe all your listeners, also in the recording, will be back after the summer. We will have a webinar Wednesday on the September the 2nd. So please join us then. And maybe if you have some more questions, please join us at the Aramid's roundtable at the lounge. So we go into the lounge, and the next 30 minutes you can join us, and then we can take it from there and discuss with her. Thank you for now. See you later in the lounge, or I'll see you next webinar Wednesday on September 2nd.